Hey guys, Dr. Davin Lim, board certified dermatologist. Today we'll be talking about the use of isotretinoin, in other words, Accutane or oratane, in the timing of certain procedures like lasers, microneedling, and even things like hair removal. So a lot of this talk will be based upon evidence-based medicine. So it's not just hearsay, not just how I feel, but what's actually out in the literature and what most dermatologists throughout the world practice. So just as a background, as you know, patients who are on Accutane or oratane or isotretinoin, as the correct name should be used, there are certain warnings in regards to procedures. So in the past, there's things like laser resurfacing, peels, and even simple things like hair removal that you can't have whilst being on this medication, but you need that 6 to 12 months clearance based upon PI or product information. So this has been rewritten, and it's been rewritten 4 years ago, and it's been rewritten in many peer-reviewed journals, including the big JAMA journal, which is the Journal of the American Medical Association. So that was done in 2017. Many other peer-reviewed journals have actually revised that. So guys, just as a background, why are dermatologists worried in regards to Accutane in the context of procedures? Because historically, in the 1980s and a couple of case reports in the 1990s, it showed that patients on a relatively high dose of Accutane, when we're talking about around 1 milligram per kilogram per day. So let's say if you're 70 kilos, that's 70 milligrams or higher per day. And they had some case reports of early lasers, for example, argon lasers, and really, really deep chemical peels causing horrendous scarring. So since then, based upon those case reports, there's been a blanket cover by the company, initially by Roche, who manufactured roaccutane, that there has to be a clearance between 6 to 12 months. And this stuck with the medical community for approximately 40 years before it was revamped, yeah? So as a dermatologist, we know that there's a marked variability in regards to how patients tolerate Accutane. So some patients may have horrendous side effects, while some patients are just side effect free. So when we talk about the safety data, we've got to actually look at, I guess, the cases where there's a lot of, or the people who are more prone to the side effects and go, cool, is this related to the actual drug itself, or is it related to the procedure? And hence this review articles over the last couple of years. So the bottom line is this: as specialists, as dermatologists, we understand that certain procedures are compatible with the use of oral isotretinoin. So which procedures? Instead of listing a whole heap of procedures, I'll give you the two procedures or three procedures which are relatively contraindicated. Well, I wouldn't say real, absolute contraindication. So the first one is deep chemical peels. So deep chemical peels, they have different types. Just as a background, if you're using something medium to deep, so anything more than a TCA 30%, that's considered a medium depth peel. So all your Jesna TCAs, 25-30%, they should not be allowed. I wouldn't say not allowed, in extreme caution, especially when you're doing global peels. That doesn't apply for TCA cross, because TCA cross, whether you're using 100% TCA or anywhere between 70 to 100% TCA, or if you're using phenol croton oil peel, so 88% phenol croton oil, they're still considered a deep peel. But the flip side is that for chemical peels, we can class it as deep peels or medium depth deep peels that are global, in other words, whole face. You can call it segmental. For example, if you're doing the upper lip or upper lower lips or around the eyes, that's segmental peeling. And then there's focal peeling. So in the context of scar revision, most of the chemical peels, we're using focal chemical peels. So there's not segmental and it's not global. So generally speaking, you can use TCA and you can use phenol croton oils only in focal applications. So that's the first thing. No global, nothing medium, nothing deep, global. Segmental, probably defer that. And the second one is ablative laser. So ablative lasers include CO2 and erbium resurfacing. Now, CO2 and erbium can be done fully ablative. In other words, 100% of the skin surface is treated. That's called fully ablative laser resurfacing. So once again, that is relatively contraindicated if you're doing it superficial. If you're doing medium to deep, that's an absolute contraindication. So most of us, including myself, would not do an aggressive, fully ablative laser resurfacing because we know skin takes a lot longer to heal up on Accutane. So those are the main two. The third one is extensive surgery. So if you're doing things like punch excision or punch elevation or just any one of those basic procedures, I don't think there's a problem at all. But if I'm doing something like complex flap surgery or even graft, excluding dermal grafts, but just grafting, for example, in the context of skin cancer, for extensive flap surgery or extensive surgical operations where you know you're excising big portions of skin, I probably think that is that should be deferred until you've got that clearance. Now, the clearance in regards to Accutane, how do we actually figure that out? It's hard because there's no guidelines. If you look at the PI or product information, they say anywhere between 6 to 12 months. Dermatologists realize that well within that 1 month mark, the drug is out of your system. But your mucocutaneous side effects, in other words, the side effects on your lips, on your skin, on photosensitivity, it may take a couple of weeks, sometimes even months before they resolve. So the way I look at things is I base it upon the history as well. So if someone's got extraordinary mucocutaneous side effects, drying of the lips, thin skin, easily scratched, lots of photosensitivity, I give them a much longer washout compared to someone who's been on a low dose isotretinoin regime for months or even a year, who's got virtually zero side effects, yeah? And so with those, I may give them a washout of anywhere between 6 weeks to 3 months before the fully ablative, deep fully ablative, and also the extensive surgical procedures. So those are my guidelines. Guys, and that's reflected, like I said, not only in one or two journals, it's been in peer-reviewed journals where it's multi-center studied over many, many years. Now, does every dermatologist or plastic surgeon follow this? The answer is no. So your dermatologist may have their own opinions. Maybe they don't read the literature. I don't know, but it's been out there. It's in all the dermatology journals in regards to the safety. So once again, it's not an absolute safety. You got to understand, guys, it's not an absolute safety. It is based upon relative safety. So when we're looking at the side effects from any one of those procedures, whether it be radiofrequency microneedling, laser resurfacing, chemical peels, laser hair removal, we look at that compared to the population base, which has not been on isotretinoin, and the population base who's been on relatively, I wouldn't say low, but within, you know, anywhere between 5 to 40 milligrams isotretinoin. But once again, your dermatologist will base that upon your individual side effects and come up with a safety profile based upon you. Okay, the other thing I like to touch on is the other side effects of isotretinoin or Accutane. So one thing we know, when patients are on this medication, it changes the flora of your skin. So in other words, your staph colonization, in other words, the bacteria on your skin actually is increased. This colonization is increased, especially intranasally, so up your nose. And that's why we have things like colitis, in other words, chapped lips or cracked lips or infection, angular colitis on the sides of your lips. They can all increase with isotretinoin use. So when I perform procedures, when patients are on isotretinoin or Accutane, even if they're on a low, low dose, you know, like 10 milligrams or 20 milligrams, it's usually my recommendations and my standard of practice to prescribe them an antibiotic. So there's a relative contraindication with antibiotics, for example, like doxycycline, minocycline, because you can have increased side effects in your brain, increased blood pressure there. So we call it benign intracranial hypertension. So most of us prescribe either erythromycin, and we normally do it a short course. So I normally go erythromycin twice a day for a period of about 7 days after the procedure. So if the skin's going to heal up, expected heal up time of, let's say, 5-6 days, if you have some mild mucocutaneous side effects from Accutane, it may take you that extra 12, 24 hours longer. And hence I cover with that antibiotic for that period of time. And once again, that's out of safety rather than anything else. What I normally do as well, if I'm having patients who I'm doing for example, a relatively aggressive fractional ablative laser or even RFM, radio frequency microneedling, coupled with subcision, I normally ask them to cease the isotretinoin maybe a week before, even 3-4 days before, and then pick it back up when the skin heals. So it might be another 5 to 8 to 10 days. So just by that, by doing that, it increases the safety profile, and importantly, it actually increases the healing. Well, it decreases the healing up time, and it can mitigate the side effects from staph colonization. So guys, this is how I do it. Your dermatologist, your plastic surgeon will have their own viewpoints in regards to that. The last thing I'll talk about is other procedures which can be allowed with isotretinoin. Why has, the big question I guess is, why has the manufacturers of these, of this drug, yeah, of isotretinoin, why haven't they changed it in their PI or the product information? I guess it's pretty easy to understand because they're probably lazy. It's not only that, it's much easier to do a blanket cover rather than revise things based upon evidence-based medicine. So as far as I'm concerned, the product information still says that 6 to 12 months washout. But like I said, it's basically the companies just can't be bothered doing that. So the other thing we'll talk about, like the last thing we'll talk about, are procedures. For example, laser hair removal. Now, even before the revision, most dermatologists know that using sensible settings with good lasers, epidermal cooling, contact gel, all that sort of stuff, that can decrease the side effects of any potential adverse outcomes from laser resurfacing, or in this situation, hair removal. So in my practice, certainly everyone's got the go-ahead, the green light for laser hair removal based upon those guidelines. Now, if anyone's in doubt, it's really easy. If anyone's in doubt, someone's got really brittle skin, someone who peels very easily, gets sunburns, scratches, poor wound healing, really easy, do a test spot. So what you want to do is just fire a couple of shots on the site, maybe about 2 or 3 shots, call the patient back or ask them to send you some photos in a week's time to have a look. Is the skin healing up as expected? That's one way to test. And the other thing as well is just ask. Yeah. So when we're looking at for side effects, we're asking, like I mentioned, you know, whether they, when they shave their legs, for example, or guys when they shave their face, if their skin gets increased fragility, that's when your red flags happen and just go, you know what? For this patient, I might want to reduce the dose. I might want to speak to the dermatologist to reduce the dose. I might want to do test spots. I might want to use a lower fluence, a longer pulse duration. So many ways to mitigate a lot of the risk. Guys, I hope you liked that video. It's a short one, but it's a problem which we see all the time as consulting dermatologists. And I hope it clarifies things. Thanks for watching. If you like, please like, share, subscribe, give me your thoughts. See you later. Bye.